Alrighty, here we are in part 2 of the Astartes Disparity. And for those just tuning in, I mentioned in part 1 what I thought were the three areas of lack when it came to Codex Space Marines. And we are comparing these areas against the Chaos Space Marine Codex, not only because they are similar, but also because they came out at essentially the same time and remain far more competitive compared to our Loyalist Marines. In part 1, I go over the disparity between stratagems. If you haven't seen part 1, you can find a link at the top somewhere or in the description of this video. Now, let's get into psychic powers. I should mention, at the time of recording this video, all the psychic powers we are going to cover that last beyond the psychic phase last until your next psychic phase. Here is the Astartes Librarius discipline, and beside it, the Heretics Dark Hereticus discipline. And like with my previous tables, I've reordered the psychic powers in a way where relatable or similar psychic powers are in the same row. Let's begin. Smite. Pretty simple. All psychers have access to this power. Given that all psychic tests are taken on 2 dice, at a warp charge value of 5, it's pretty easy to cast. Its only limitation is that it affects the closest visible unit. It is also the only power that can be attempted more than once per psychic phase, and it acts as the baseline power we can compare other offensive psychic powers against. Veil of Time and Warp Time. Both buffing powers that affect mobility, both at a warp charge value of 6, and both work on friendly units. The first area of difference is its effective range, with Veil of Time being 18 inches and Warp Time only being 3. Warp Time will let the unit you cast it on move again. While it sounds like you're getting less with Warp Time, I have to lean with it as being the superior power. Don't believe me? Consider the scenarios in which Veil of Time would be useful. One would be, you have a unit you want to charge, but your charge distance is pretty far. It would be far better to pass a psychic test and move closer to the unit, reducing the difficulty of your charge, than having to pass a psychic test and getting to re-roll a charge that was already difficult. And as for that advancing scenario, well, since the move phase happens before the psychic phase, you won't get any value from that re-roll to advance until your next turn, where instead you could just use warp time to simply move again. So it is usually the case that warp time would serve you better, since most units don't gain anything from advancing, other than a minus 1 to hit on their assault weapons. So sure, Veil of Time is a little lackluster to me in comparison to Warp Time, but that's only because Warp Time has insane utility. Being able to move a unit more than once in a game where a unit will usually only move 5 times will allow you to move into critical locations that you would otherwise not be able to. Next up, Might of Heroes and Diabolic Strength. Both have the same warp charge value of 6, both work on friendly models within 12 inches. The only difference here is the Diabolic Strength doesn't buff your toughness. Instead, it further buffs your strength. And it's thematic, speaking to the differences between the factions. The next two comparisons are on powers which are commonly referred to as worse smites. This term came about because of the fact that smite is often easier to cast and can be attempted more than once per psychic phase. And it's usually a mechanically simpler spell as a mechanism to deal mortal wounds. The first comparison is Psychic Scourge and Infernal Gaze. Comparing these to Smite, we can see that Psychic Scourge has a slightly higher warp charge cost and has the same effective range as Smite. That increased cost is a pretty good trade-off though, since you don't have to select the closest unit, meaning that you could potentially use it to snipe some mortal wounds on key enemy characters. But the mechanic uses the target and the caster rolling off against each other, adding their leadership to the roll. Since HQ characters usually have a decent leadership, it leads quite a bit of the effectiveness of this power up to chance. It results in this power being best used as a worse smite, since you are more likely to get the D3 mortal wounds against enemy troops rather than characters. Compare that to Infernal Gaze. Not only is this power as cheap as Smite, but you can still pick any visible unit, and you roll 3 dice, and for each roll of 4 up, you do a mortal wound. So it's the same cost of Smite, and with none of its targeting limitations. And where Smite is 1 to 3 wounds, Infernal Gaze is 0 to 3. And since you're making those rolls yourself, not cross-checking against the leadership of your target, you can actually use this to plink mortal wounds onto key characters. The second comparison in our Smite-like spells is Fury of the Ancients and Gift of Chaos. Fury of the Ancients, at a warp charge value of 7, has roughly a 50% chance of going off, and its range is 3d6, meaning at the most, the range is the same as Smite, and at the worst, it's 3 inches. You pick an enemy unit and draw a line to a model within your range rolled. Each unit the line passes through suffers 1 mortal wound, definitely a worse Smite. Firstly, it costs more, its range isn't better, and you can only ever do 1 mortal wound to a unit. But the biggest deal breaker for me is, to get the most of its effectiveness, it wants you to go up close and get your librarian into the thick of battle, which is honestly not where you want him to be. Gift of Chaos, on the other hand, is a warp charge value of 6, but requires you to select an enemy model within 6 inches. If manifested, roll a d6, and if the result is greater than target's toughness, they suffer d3 plus 3 mortal wounds. This can be real good. If you are facing Guard or Eldar equivalents, whose baseline toughness for characters is 3, it gives you a 50% chance of dealing 4 to 6 mortal wounds on them. And if the character is slain, you get a Chaos Spawn added to your army. Next up, some buffing powers. Psychic Fortress and Prescience. Auto-passing morale for Astartes isn't a great perk, when they already have an inbuilt ability that usually prevents casualties from fleeing. So the only real perk of the power as I see it is a 4 plus ignore wounds, which for a warp charge value of 5 is pretty nice. Prescience is a far better power, however, adding 1 to all hit rolls in the shooting and fight phase, but it also costs more to cast. Lastly, we got Null Zone and Death Hex. And these two are mechanically comparable because they both are all about shutting down invulnerable saves. What separates them is how they're implemented. Null Zone creates an aura within 6 inches of the Psyker, and Death Hex selects a single target. Both powers require a warp charge value of 8, and with their ranges, both powers will probably be in deny range. However, while it would appear that Null Zone is far more powerful, it's a 6-inch aura. Because of that, it is essentially a Hail Mary. If that power fails, that librarian is a little screwed. And if the idea is to use it defensively, it can still fail to go off, and you just have to hope that your tools are still intact so that you can try and attempt the power next turn. These are problems that do exist for Death Hex as well, but it exists to a far less degree due to the fact that it can be casted from further away, and you don't have to have your librarian moved into position before attempting to cast the power. And then we have the 3 Chaos Mark powers available to the Dark Hereticus discipline. All warp charge 6, selecting a marked unit within 18 inches, providing either an improved invulnerable save, a minus 1 to hit, or 5 up feel no pain. These are all fantastic powers, as across all 3 of them, you have nearly every method covered when it comes to increasing the resiliency of your units. So, let's review. I think it's pretty clear that the Heretics have a superior suite of powers. Here's my suggestion. Buff a few of the powers within the Librarius discipline, so that they have 6 useful powers. There is a reason why every librarian runs Might of Heroes and Null Zone, because they are far and away the best powers to have. The other two are Worse Smites, and Veil of Time and Psychic Fortress are just okay. The Heretics, though, I think they should stay the same. They should have a superior psychic discipline. I mean, it makes sense that if you are one of the Lost and the Damned, you would have a greater affinity to warp magic. Now, let's get into the last section of this analysis, units. So, 10,000 years ago, all Space Marines were friends fighting on the same side. So naturally, in the present 40k, there are a lot of shared unit or Chaos equivalents of the same unit. Tactical Marines, Chaos Marines, Predators, Chaos Predators, Dreadnoughts, and Hellbrutes, you get the idea. However, each Codex offers unique units as well, and within those unique units available to the Loyalists and the Heretics, there is a differential in power. Now, there are obviously some strong units in Codex Space Marines. I mean, a max fat squad of Hellblasters is powerful. Aggressors are nasty. They can put out the hurt. But so too can the unique units available to Codex Chaos Space Marines. But the Chaos Space Marines have more of what I would refer to as choice units. The quality that these units share is the level of impact they bring with regards to accomplishing their job within the rules of 40k 8th edition. These are units which the Loyalists have no real equivalent for, or if they do have a similar type of unit, they fail to match up and deliver the same impact. Let me explain. The first of our choice units is Cultists, a cheap chaff troops option. To start with, what are the jobs of your troops? 1. To sit on or contest objectives, in other words, be difficult to displace. Well, as a chaff type unit, they are only toughness 3 with 1 wound and a 6 up save. Being a 10 man unit will mean your opponent will have to get through 10 wounds before they are eliminated. The other job of your troops is to fill out the troop slot on detachments, allowing you to create rich detachments which yield more command points. To illustrate my point, let's keep it consistent and take the minimum necessary models to make up a unit. And at 4 points a model, you can fill out the 3 slots of a battalion for 120 points. Why is this so good? And why does it make them a choice unit? Well, it's all relative. The other troops' choice available to the Heretics are Chaos Space Marines. How well do they perform the job of troops? Well, being toughness 4 with 1 wound and a 3 up save, you would think that they'd be better at holding objectives, but the minimum squad size is 5, meaning the unit only has 5 wounds total. And costing 13 points per marine, they will fill out the 3 slots of a battalion for 195 points. Sure, they are stronger and they can have better war gear, but that only further increases their cost, and you can use the points saved towards units that will more than make up for the strength differential lost by going with cultists, as generally, heavy support elites and HQs are heavier hitters compared to troops. Essentially, cultists are superior at doing the tasks required of troops. So, how about the loyal Astartes? How do their troops fare? Well, we can rule out tactical marines as they are nearly identical to Chaos Space Marines when it comes to stats and points as it relates to the job at hand. That leaves two troop choices available. Let's start with scouts. Now, scouts are toughness 4 with 1 wound and a 4-up save. Sort of a middle ground between the cultist and the standard marine stat line. And they have the unique ability to deploy outside of their deployment zone, allowing them to control objectives that would otherwise be unreachable early in a game. But like tactical and chaos marines, their minimum squad size is 5, giving the unit a total wound count of 5. And at 11 points per model, they'll cost 165 points to fill out the battalion's troops requirement. From the troop options available to the Space Marines, these are your cheapest option, but they are still more expensive and have less total wounds than the cultists do. However, if you match up against a non-fly melee-centric army, the scouts will prove to be invaluable with regards to roadblocking your opponent's path. But outside of that scenario, they are still inferior to cultists and their equivalents in both aspects of their job. The second troop choice available to Space Marines are Primaris Intercessors. They are toughness 4 with 2 wounds and a 3-up save. Which is actually pretty great. They are just as resilient as a standard variety of marines, but with that extra wound, your squad of 5 will provide you with 10 wounds total, putting their wound total on a level field with cultists, with a superior toughness and save characteristic. But at 18 points per model, it'll cost 270 points to fill out that battalion. The Intercessors do have superior weaponry, using bolt rifles over the standard bolt guns, so it's definitely easier to justify them over normal marines. When it comes to the job of troops, cultists are more efficient at this job for their points cost. As I mentioned earlier, the better war gear of Intercessors is somewhat invalidated, as the points you save in cultists can be used to bring in other units, which will almost always outperform the damage of a troop's choice, resulting in cultists doing the required job of their role, securing objectives and generating CP, at a far more efficient level than any of the other troops options available in Codex Space Marines and Codex Chaos Space Marines. And that sort of brings us to the next choice unit I wanted to highlight, which are Demon Princes. First thing to do is to look at the job of an HQ. Outside of being required to fill detachments, the HQ's main job is to bring value. I know it sounds vague, but let me explain. This usually takes one of two forms. One being a ranged buffing character, think of a Primaris Librarian or a Captain, and the other being referred to as a beatstick. A loyalist example would be a jump pack style Smash Captain. Now, the Demon Prince fills the beatstick role to a great effect, but it's also a great buffing character as well. Similar to the Space Marine Captain or the Chaos Lord, the Demon Prince's ability, Prince of Chaos, will allow friendly units within 6 inches to reroll hit rolls of 1, making him identical to the Space Marine Captain or Chaos Lord when it comes to providing support. But in addition to this, the Demon Prince can also be a Psyker, which offers further utility and support to friendly units. But where the Demon Prince truly shines is in combat. Typically taken with 2 Malefic Talons, the Demon Prince has 7 attacks, hitting on 2s, rerolling 1s, thanks to his own Prince of Chaos ability. At Strength 7, AP minus 2, and 2 damage. He is a literal monster in combat, as he should be. But his most standout quality to me is the fact that he's less than 10 wounds, meaning he can advance behind another unit, screening him from being targeted, and use his psychic abilities to either do some mortal wounds, or buff his screening unit, or himself. And when he is ready, he can move 12 inches with fly over his screening unit to charge his target. Given the current loadout I described, it would put the Demon Prince's cost at about 180 points. The most comparable HQ unit the Astartes could bring is a Captain with a jump pack armed with a Thunderhammer and Storm Shield. While being cheaper at 129 points, the Captain with jump pack falls short in a few areas. His overall stat line is inferior, but most importantly, his volume of attacks is far lower at 4. And his Thunderhammer, while it hits harder than the Demon Prince's talons do have the unwieldy quality, which increases the odds his attacks will miss. And he isn't a Psyker. In summary, the Demon Prince brings a durable, highly dangerous melee unit, which offers greater support to nearby units by being active in both the psychic and fight phases. Whereas the Smash Captain is less durable, highly dangerous, but also less reliable in the damage he deals, which offers less support to nearby units, and with this loadout, is only active in the fight phase. The last unit I want to highlight is Obliterators, which are similar to the Demon Prince in that they can remain safe in Deep Strike until we are ready to unleash them. But as a ranged specialist, it essentially allows them to fill a role I will refer to as a delete queue, since you can wait and decide which of your opponent's units is a problem, and delete them. The closest thing the Loyalists have to fill this role are Plasma Inceptors. Let's run through and compare their stats. Movement, Obliterators have 4 inches of movement, while the Inceptors have 10 inches of fly. For the purpose of a delete queue, this favor can effectively be ignored, as they both will deep strike in and unleash their guns. Both have a ballistic skill of 3+. Obliterators are strength 5, toughness 4, while the Inceptors are strength 4, toughness 5. Which is good in the favor of Inceptors, as that extra toughness will keep them a bit more resilient. Obliterators have 3 wounds each, whereas Inceptors have 2 wounds each. Obliterators have a total of 9 attacks, versus the Inceptors 7. Again, this is irrelevant, as these units aren't trying to be in combat. When it comes to saves, the Obliterators have a 2-up armor save and 5-up invuln save, while the Inceptors only have a 3-up armor save. But it's important to keep in mind that the Inceptors' guns, when fired in their supercharged mode, can result in them being slain, effectively making their toughness 5 and 3-up armor save and multiple wounds useless should it occur. We still have a fairly comparable stat line with regards to firing performance, but the Obliterators' increased wound count and superior saves gives them the edge when it comes to the resilience as it relates to the job at hand. So let's take a look at their guns. It is a little complex to analyze, but both units' weapons have a variable property in different areas. When it comes to range, Obliterators win out at 24 inches versus 18. The Obliterators have a consistent volume of fire at 12 shots, but the stats are variable each time they fire. Strength 7 to 9, AP minus 1 to minus 3, damage 1 to 3. The Inceptors have a variable number of shots at 63. At strength 8, AP minus 3, 2 damage, if you supercharge. Since D3s average out on 2s, the guns would appear to have a similar performance, but this actually isn't the case. The Obliterators are far better served by having a consistent volume of fire, as at a worst case scenario, they do 12 strength 7 shots at AP minus 1, 1 damage. Now this is fairly unlikely, but should it happen, you're able to command point reroll the stat of your choice. Inceptors, on the other hand, are worse off. Since each Plasma Exterminator is its own weapon, if all 6 D3 rolled result in a 1, which is far less likely, it can't be helped as well, since you can only improve 1 out of the 6 dice rolled. Furthermore, since you are supercharging the Plasma Exterminators to get the damage of 2, you probably want to save your command point to prevent your own guy from dying. This should be quite clear now that Obliterators are a superior delete key type of unit available to the Chaos Space Marines, which the Loyalists have no real equivalent for. All of those perks over the Inceptors for 6 points more per model compared to the Plasma Inceptors. And if you think the points differential justifies their increased performance, consider the fact that you can mark your Obliterators as Slaanesh and they become eligible for the Endless Cacophony stratagem, allowing them to fire twice in a single turn. I feel like my point is pretty clear. These units are outliers within the Chaos Space Marines Codex, as you almost never see a Chaos Space Marines list that doesn't use them. And this is because they are units that do their jobs really, really well. So well that no single unit can perform their jobs at a comparable efficiency within their own codex, never mind the Loyalists' codex. No troop choices do their jobs as well for as efficient of a points cost as cultists. No HQs can be as durable, as deadly, and as active in as many phases as demon princes, and no heavy support units can remain as safe and simply appear and delete units as effectively as Obliterators. The solution segment. Well, how do we resolve these unit discrepancies? As easy as it would be to add a Loyalist equivalent to cultists with an identical point cost, I think that's the wrong approach. For one, it's cool for factions to have unique offerings from other factions. And for two, it wouldn't solve the problem that people aren't fielding Marines. And reducing the cost of Marines isn't ideal either, as you shouldn't have hordes of Marines to compensate for their lack of resilience. The problem, to me, is that Marines' current resilience doesn't justify their points cost. Toughness 4 and a 3-up armor save isn't as valuable as GW initially thought it would be. I think this needs to be solved with an ability given to Marines across the board. What I find interesting is how Astartes are treated in Kill Team, and while I understand that it is a different game with different mechanics, what comes to mind is the ability in Kill Team for Astartes called Transhuman Physiology, which all Astartes have, whether Loyalists or Chaos. All Astartes have an ability which adds value which separates them from standard infantry, and better justifies their points cost. I think something similar needs to be implemented in 40k, because like I mentioned earlier, people don't take Marines. A simple idea would be to reroll failed saves against weapons with an AP value of 0. This would better reflect the narrative resilience that Marines are known for, while ensuring they are still vulnerable to the weapons that should be able to hurt them. And it keeps more elite Imperium units like Custodes still superior. The Demon Prince. Well, I definitely don't think that the Loyalists need an equivalent to the Demon Prince. Demon Princes are a thematic and iconic unit to the Heretic Astartes. But I will ask this, are Demon Princes overpowered? because I'm having a hard time thinking of another unit that is as deadly as Demon Princes and also remain untargetable and bring as much value. The one that comes to mind are Tau Commanders, which have been limited to one per detachment, and the only other one I can think of are Custodian Shield Captains on jet bikes. But they don't have the psychic flexibility of Demon Princes, nor does the rest of their army have the necessary unit variety of the Chaos Space Marines Codex when it comes to creating a well-rounded list. Looking at Obliterators, I feel that it is pretty convenient for Obliterators to randomly spawn weapons that are always at a great strength. What if, instead of 6 plus D3 for strength, it was 5 plus D3? Just an idea. There are always clear winners in a Codex, as certain stratagems, powers, and traits yield super effective combos. But try to find another unit in any Codex that invalidates so many units from being chosen, regardless of the subfaction. In the case of Chaos Space Marines, every Legion's best choice for heavy support is Obliterators, and in a range as vast as the Heretic Astartes, it's a real shame. So, in conclusion, across both parts of this video, we have gone through at length the areas which cause Space Marines to be in such a poor state compared to Chaos Space Marines, with inferior stratagems, psychic powers, and no real choice units that are conducive to the core mechanics and demands of 40k 8th edition. And based on those findings, we can safely say that when it comes to Space Marines versus Chaos Space Marines, where do each excel? Psychic. Most definitely the Heretics, as we've systematically gone over both psychic disciplines and proved the superiority of the Dark Hereticus discipline. And narratively, it makes sense for it to be so. Shooting. Well, with units as effective as Obliterators and powerful stratagems like Fire Frenzy and Endless Cacophony and Veterans of the Long War, the Heretics definitely deal more damage in the shooting phase. Fighting. Again, here the Heretics win out. With heavy hitters like Demon Princes, War Gear options, and Relics all about increasing combat volume and performance, combined with Veterans of the Long War, they definitely pack a bigger punch in the fight phase as well. Defense. With an abundance of 5-up demonic invuln saves across various units, and a psychic table that can provide increased invulnerable saves, a -1 to hit, and a 5-up feel no pain, the Heretics also have better defensive options as well. I mean, holy hell, look at this. It doesn't make any sense. It's pitiful. But it explains why the best strategy available to Space Marines is to stack your entire army around reroll auras with an Ancient. Because the only way you can increase your performance is by dying near a flag, which will maybe allow you to shoot again. You see, the primary reason why the Heretics are better in nearly all areas is because of the Loyalist's poor suite of stratagems. And when you think about it, that is the last place the Loyalists should be lacking. Well, that wraps up this two-parter Thoughts on Video. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, hit that thumbs up button. If you want to help out the channel, please subscribe. What do you guys think about the Astartes disparity? Do you agree with my points, or have a point that I missed? Leave a comment below, as I'd be happy to hear from you. Well, until next time, happy wargaming.